For Anime Today, we've got Nick.
Hello.
We've got Allison.
Hi there.
And hi there, Peter.
Hi. Hi to you all.
It's good to get a chance to talk to you on the phone, finally.
Yes. Well, I'm never far from a phone, I guess.
You started performing at a very, very young age. How did you get started in the business?
Well, I really got started when I was 7 years old. I was a child model, doing everything from pianos to Hostess cupcakes to you name it.
Wow.
And then I was always very often working with a little blonde girl whose mother had great ambitions for her to go on the stage, and talked my mother into going, sending me to an audition for a play. I got the part. And we showed up for the first day of rehearsal. And at the end of the day, my mother said, "We're not coming back." I said, "What?" She said, "The theater's dirty."
Well, that's something a mom would think of.
I don't know. You know, it usually is when there's no play playing. So we didn't go back. She sent another boy to show up the next day. And then I got called for another audition to meet Ethel Barrymore, who was a famous actress at that time. Mm-hmm. And we went up to see her at her hotel. And it was on my birthday. And left the meeting and got in the elevator. My mother said, "Well, they want you for the part." Well, I didn't model again after that, but I was with that first play for 2 years on Broadway, toured the United States, Canada. It was a great experience. So after that, I became an actor. And did a bunch of Broadway shows. And you didn't have to audition for radio if you were on Broadway, because everybody came to see the shows. So I was doing a lot of Broadway and a lot of radio shows, and I still love that medium.
How did you transition into doing voice work and you know, with the films and with, you know, with the animated series?
Well, that you know, is a result partly of radio experience when I was a kid. In 1960 or so, all the radio shows, almost all, went off the air because television had come on so strongly, and it was now hooked up to California. But I didn't want to go to California. So gradually I got called for little dubbing jobs as an actor. And I saw that the real money was in the directing of these dubbed films. So I had also been writing and selling my work. And I kept insisting, "I can write these." Well, I finally was allowed to write one. And then I found that the money was in the directing, not in the writing, which took forever. Directing was easy. So I went on strike, a one-man strike. I said, "I'm not doing any of this unless I can write and direct."
It's irrelevant for today.
And at the same time, a man was saying, said, "Pete, I need a ghostwriter for a series, an animated series I'm doing, and I want you to write some of them, or most of them, actually, and I'll pay you $100 an episode." $100, jeepers. That was kind of low for the work involved, but I took it, and that was Astro Boy, a series called Astro Boy. So I did most of the scripts for that, and then along came a show called Gigantor, and I wrote a lot of the scripts for that, but then I was cast in it also. So that really got me into animation, and along came Speed Racer, and not through that man, the Gigantor and Astro Boy guy. Fred Ladd, his name was. He's still alive, and he's really a very lively guy. So
yes.
Speed Racer came through some editors, and I looked at it and I said, "Holy mackerel, this is a really good series." And agreed to write and direct it. My only instructions for doing that series were Americanize it. Well, that gave me a free rein to name the characters and give them crazy names and write the dialogue and cast it. So I cast myself as Speed and Racer X. Well, I was right for them. And then three other talented people that I had known for many, many years, and that was the four of us doing the series. And that was really the start of getting involved with anime and things like that.
Yeah, go ahead.
It's interesting to see how the people in some of these early series all know each other and interrelate, because just recently we had an opportunity to talk to Fred, and that was it was really a fun discussion about all the history of Astro Boy and a number of other early shows.
Yes. To talk to whom?
Fred Ladd.
Oh, Fred. Oh, well, then sure.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but we spent about 2 hours on the phone with him talking about some of the early shows, so.
I'm surprised you could get off with 2 hours. Fred can go on forever. No, we're both fond of each other. He knows it.
Well, going on with Speed Racer, what were some of the challenges that you faced when you were adapting it for the broadcast?
Well, one, of course, to make it really sound, you know, really current dialogue. One of the real challenges was to cut down some of the violence. And most of the time, there's no way to do it. There'd be this horrendous car crash. You'd see arms and legs flying all over the place.
Oh, my gosh.
Yes, I know. So, but I would then throw in a line like, well, he's in the hospital in critical condition, and the doctors say he'll pull through. And then there were a couple of other little things that I had cut out, such as the symbol, really, for somebody sleeping in animated films was a drop would come from their nose. Then they'd inhale and would go back up and down. I thought, no, that's not for the kids. So I had those shots taken out. Those were the real challenges. The other challenges were in the studio because it was an exhausting day. Our energy level had to be very high, and because, you know, it's racing going on all the time. Mm-hmm. And it would take a full day, 7 or 8 hours, to do one episode. Dubbing it, where you had to look at a little loop, that little section, memorize the lines, and then try to sync them right into those mouths up there, which was a challenge because sometimes the mouths were impossible to sync a line in.
Yeah.
You know, those were the main challenges, I would say.
Did you find there were any episodes that you just flat out could not adapt at all to the U.S. market?
No. The other problem I had, actually, was, now that I think of it, was that I got the episodes sporadically from Japan. They'd come in one or two at a time or three. Mm-hmm. I never knew what was coming up. So when a mysterious racer, a real villainous-looking guy, appeared with that sort of helmet on, I didn't know what to call him, so I called him Racer X. I had no idea of who he really was.
So you weren't given character bios or any
clues
of what was
like
upcoming?
That. No, and the translations from Japan at that time were rather crude, which in a way I guess was good because then I really could make up crazy dialogue. One of my favorite kind of lines is, this dangerous situation is getting dangerous.
Oh, goodness. You're also responsible for the memorable English theme song. How did that come about?
Well, we couldn't use, of course, the one in Japanese or the arrangement. So I had been doing writing and acting on a series of MGM children's records. And the group from that, when this came in, I wrote the words and then got Danny Davis he was a conductor, and bring in a group of musicians, and they're the ones who put together the song, really, in a nighttime session with closed, locked doors. And Danny Davis, whose music it is, and whose voice is one of the voices singing, has been in Nashville for many, many years with his own group called Danny Davis and the Nashville Brass. It's the biggest hit they ever had.
I wonder if they still sing it in Nashville.
They don't. He said he's never played it.
Oh.
I know, he didn't realize.
That's surprising, considering Speed Racer kind of did a revival a few years back. It would have been interesting to have that out there again.
Yep.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, well, it was on, the Cartoon Network for a while, too, after MTV.
Yeah. Yep.
And they're making some new Speed Racers. Actually, they made two series based on the original 52, and they were awful. I mean, everybody admits it. Oh, terrible. The animation was terrible, the story, the acting on them was terrible. So I just finished recording another attempt at Speed Racer, which takes place about 35 years after the original 52. I think they're calling it Speed Racer 2008. And I'm just working as an actor on it, and I'm playing a different part from Speed. You'll never guess. I'm playing Spritel.
Oh.
He's that little impish guy that was always jumping into the trunk of the Mach 5 with his pet chimpanzee. Well, now he's a 40 or 45-year-old man who runs a garage and a driving school.
Wow.
Oh, goodness. Oh,
that's cool.
Of course, now we don't have to dub these series. You pre-record them, which is so much easier. The animators are the ones who have to then work from our voice tracks.
When you originally recorded this, was the studio sessions, did you do these individually by yourselves, or did you actually still do it as a group back then?
We did it as a group.
Do you think that made it easier or more hard as compared to now?
Well, it was a whole different way of doing it. I think now it's harder on the actor. Because, for instance, when I was doing Courage the Cowardly Dog, I'd have one actor in at a time. And I felt sorry for the actor, but I'd have to torture him. He'd be outdone in an hour. But I'd have to torture him to get as many different readings to give the animators a choice of how they want that line to work. In those days, you had the screen right in front of you. You had the picture. So there was only one way it was going to work. I tried to cut the loops in those days short because we did have to memorize them. Some were almost impossible to memorize. You memorize it, get a good take, and you move on to the next one. So it was instantaneous memorization and instantaneous forget. Otherwise, you'd be nuts by the end of the day, which we were anyway.
Oh, well, there you go. Moving on to some of your other projects. What were some of your favorite experiences doing other work, such as your ADR work on anime series and the ADR work you've done for the Hollywood films and for foreign films as well?
Well, I worked mainly doing feature films for a company called Titra. And in those days in the 60s, very, very fine films were coming from all over the world, particularly Italy, I think. Well, I can't just say particularly, but every country, and we had to write a very careful lip-sync script to make it look like English, no matter what the language. I remember working, for instance, on Egyptian films with Omar Sharif, the star, before he became an international star.
Wow.
Yeah. It was very careful training. I knew it as an actor, but I really had a good tutor up there, a director, writer at Titra, who really taught me how to write a good lip-sync script. A good example, I don't know how I can do this without you seeing my mouth, but is if I say to you, suffer much, say it silently and look at somebody as if you're insulting them.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you get that.
Yeah, we got it.
Okay, that's reverse dubbing, I guess. But that's how carefully one had to write the lip-sync scripts. There are only three letters in the alphabet in which you close your lips, and they're almost interchangeable internationally. M, B, and P. They're the only ones. So,
wow, I didn't ever think about that.
And then constructing lines, then you've got to make those fit. But you can use other words.
Yeah, that's one thing that I've always thought. It's probably in some ways got to be harder trying to match the voices and match the syntax and make it something that's believable when you're looking at live action versus something that's animated. You're able to kind of let your mind go a little bit more free when you're watching, you know, just because you associate certain types of voices and ways of talking with certain personalities that you see on screen. And, you know, how did you kind of compensate for that?
Well, we try not to compensate because there was a large group of actors in New York, particularly in the 60s, that were from radio originally and television then, but they could change their voices. They could change their voices, their way of speaking. They can even do any kind of accent. It was all going back to the radio days. Where you couldn't see anybody, and that was a theater, and it was a theater of the mind. It worked for dubbing, too. Except with the Oriental films, it had a slight problem. You couldn't have the actor, the dubbing, do good American or Ohio diction. It just didn't work. It didn't look right.
Right.
Yeah.
So we all developed a sort of Oriental accent, which didn't fit any particular country, and put that in, and it worked.
Okay. How has directing, adapting, and adapting changed over the years? Are there things that you do that are that you're doing differently in more recent years that you didn't have to do back when you started, or vice versa?
Well, nothing really has changed when you're converting something from another language. I mean, you have to stick to the story as close as you can. If you don't, you're in real trouble trying to get back on the track. So it really always starts with a script, no matter what, almost in the entertainment business, a plan or a script, and that's where you start. After that, it's a matter of casting. And if you do all those things right, the direction is, it's a piece of cake.
In addition to Speed Racer, there's quite a few other big screen adaptations planned that are based on anime classics. Do you have any opinion as to why this is starting to happen now all of a sudden?
Running out of stories. I think part of it. You know, running out of original ideas.
Yeah.
Not running out, but they're just hard to come by. And let's face it, going back to those old classics, that's why they're classics.
Yeah, they're good stories.
Yeah.
Now, there's been some stuff leaked in the press about, you know, the Astro Boy movie that's coming up and stuff. Do you have any opinions on any of these remakes as to whether you think they're going to be good or bad or anything?
I have no idea. I can't picture how they'll do Astro Boy. I was over in Berlin about 3 months ago, I guess, briefly, very briefly, to do a tiny, tiny part in the new live-action Speed Racer film. For Warner Brothers. They're finished shooting now, I think, and they're in the editing. But that's going to be sort of blockbuster. Directed and written by the Wachowski brothers, who did The Matrix. It'll be very interesting to see. Well, they told me when I was over there that they grew up on Speed Racer, that they used to run home from school to see it. Because school would have 3 or something. That went on at 3:30, and they loved it. And when this job came in, I think they've really devoted a lot of love to it, is my suspicion.
Well, it'll be interesting to see this reach an entirely different generation of kids, because I don't know how many people remember it from the MTV days like I do, you know? So maybe it'll be a nice little reliving that they can actually go back and find the Speed Racer anime from the movie.
That's true. I think that's going to happen. And they've got a good cast on in the film. Very good. Susan Sarandon is playing Mother, you know. John Goodman. You probably know all that.
Yep. I actually went to the website and watched a couple of the video interviews they did with, like, Christina Ricci and
Susan Sarandon. Oh, yes. I've seen them on the internet.
Yeah. Well, what else are you working on right now? You're very active in commercials, and you've kept very active over the years. What's up? What's on tap in the near future?
In the near future, in the nearest future, well, I do every month, and I've done it for 10 years, twice a month I do the radio ads for a chain of supermarkets that's up here called Bravo. I've been their announcer all that time. I go over and tell you what next week's chicken is going to cost. And I don't go to New York for that. I do it over in Pleasantville, New York, at a very nice little studio. But the only thing I really am firm about coming up is the festival at Javits Center on the 7th, 8th, and 9th. That's the only thing I have really scheduled.
What kind of activities do they have planned for you there?
I have no idea. They haven't told me.
Oh, goodness.
That's all right. I like it that way. They tell too much in
advance.
Surprises
are good.
Yes. I'd prefer that, actually. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've done jobs where they want to send me the script in advance. I say, I don't want to see it in advance. Yeah. You know, what am I going to do, study it?
Yeah, definitely some advantages because you get some natural reactions to everything right in the moment that way.
I think so. I think, you know, if the actor's confident enough, it's better he doesn't get the script home and come in so robotic, you know, because it's over-rehearsed.
Mm-hmm. Well, what are some of your favorite fan questions that you get when you go to anime conventions?
Oh, jeepers. I don't know. They ask everything imaginable. I don't have a favorite.
What's one of the most unusual thing you've been asked?
That I've been asked? Hmm. Well, they ask, can you still do Speed's voice? That's the usual. And yes, I can. So they say, oh, well, give it to us. So I say, I do things like, come on, Trixie, let's go.
Isn't the voice actress that played Trixie going to be sitting right next to you?
Yes, Corinne Orr. We talk on the phone almost every day.
Really?
Yeah, I'll talk to her later today.
Well, that's fantastic.
And the other cast member, one died many years ago, Jack Curtis. But Jack Grimes is still alive, who played Sparky and Chim Chim, and a lot of marvelous villain voices. He's not well, but no one even noticed him on the phone.
Okay, okay.
But getting back to fans at about Speed Racer at some of the conventions and things I've been, a couple of very unusual experiences. I've had people, you know, I've had women come up to me and say, oh, I want to marry you. I was so in love with you. And so I said, but it's a cartoon character. She said, no, I really did. You know, and their husband's standing right there. And I'll say things like, well, I think you did a lot better. You know, what else am I going to say?
Oh.
But I've had a couple of guys come up to me. One in particular I remember, he's in his 40s. He said, I just want to thank you very much. I didn't know what I was going to do when I grew up, and Speed Racer inspired me. I said, what do you do now? He said, I'm a design engineer for the Ford Motor Company.
Wow. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. And I've had a couple of guys, one Navy helicopter pilot, who said somehow he was inspired by Speed. So,
wow.
Yeah, yeah.
Why do you think the character has had such staying power with the fans over the years and had such an impact on them? What do you think it was about that character?
Well, I think it wasn't just his character, Speed's. I think the fact that it was the first in my experience, and there aren't too many, of a family. You know, there's the father, there's the mother, there's the older brother, mm-hmm. and the younger brother. And it's a family. Speed is, of course, the hero. But there's something there that you can identify with right away. And Speed is the young hero's son. And he's the right age when you want to get inspired. I've tried to in all the episodes to get across a little subtle message of some kind, you know, about decency or fair play or whatever. It's in there.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. But if you hit somebody over the head, it doesn't help.
No. Do you have any message you'd like to put out there for the anime fans listening to this podcast?
No, except it's amazing that anime has grown so big in the United States and I guess around the world. and so popular, and it continues to grow. I'm just amazed. I'm also amazed by the films that are being made. Some of them are more interesting than live-action films from Hollywood. Mm-hmm. And it's all done by artists. It's just astounding.
Mm-hmm. And in turn, that's definitely influencing artists like the Wachowski brothers. I mean, you can tell. I remember when I saw The Matrix the first time, you were like, I sat there, I'm going, oh my gosh, these guys watched a lot of anime as they were growing up. Because you could definitely, you could see the references. So I know when I found out that they were in charge of the Speed Racer movie, it's like, well, yeah, this thing has a pretty good chance of being maybe pretty cool, because they were people who are really familiar with all of the shorthand and with all of the kind of social intricacies, cultural intricacies that kind of are in the future.
True. Mm-hmm.
Well, is there anything else that you'd like to share with the fans out there?
Any questions we missed?
Anything we missed?
No, I look forward to seeing as many as possible.
Yep, and that's coming up, when is it?
That's actually coming up. That'll be coming up the weekend that this is going to be airing. This will be airing on the Friday. So when they hear this, they'll be able to hop right over to the Javits Center the next day and go see you.
Fantastic.
Okay.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for joining us. We really, really appreciate it.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Fernandez. It was great talking to you.
You have a great day.
You too.
Thanks, Peter.
All right.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.